the microphone and say, I support the rights of same-sex relations. If you feel you cannot do that, at least do not hold the microphone and say they are deviants, they are morally wrong, and things like that. So, in contrast to the people I respect so much who have been sleeping here today, ours was an issue of take the little that is being offered and use that to build. Use that to gain even more. We have a government that really doesn't care about anything else about from being in power. How do you go about reminding them that, listen, LGBT people are here. They are citizens, they pay taxes, and it is your duty not only to protect, but also to promote their human rights. How do you go about reminding them of the very many protocols they have signed? The Universal Declaration on Human Rights, the African Charter on Human and People's Rights. How do you remind them about all those declarations if they do not even listen to you? If all they believe is that you're just about 10 or 20 activists making noise, and these days they say traveling around the world. When you come to Lithuania, they imagine you've come to collect like 1 million euros and take it back and pay people to become homosexual. So, how do you begin talking to a government that actually believes that every time you get onto the plane, you're going to collect money and bring to pay Ugandans to become homosexual? That is where people like you come in. When you speak to your leaders and tell your leaders to speak to their counterparts and tell them to stop being, and I'm going to say this plainly, to tell them stop being stupid. No one is giving anyone money to go and pay someone else to be killed. I mean, it is as annoying as it is, I don't know, but that is where we need another voice to come and say, listen, you can't keep on saying this in front of the camera. It is simply embarrassing. Find a better argument. Because if you don't tell them this straight in the face, then they keep on saying, ah, no, no, no. If you find you a different job, maybe you stop being homosexual. If how do we convince the government? Because it is important in activism that you speak to the powers that be. You speak to power. You speak to the policymakers. But if the policymakers are bent on dealing with religion and culture, and some will plainly tell you, I'm 50 years old and I've never met a same-sex couple. So, you are 25 and you're telling me that, what? That you've seen more in life more than I have. How do we speak to the powers that be? We need to put our hands together. I do not blame people who are, I don't even call them homophobic, but people who do not know. Some people in Africa, some people in Uganda, have actually not had an opportunity to meet a same-sex couple. Because 99% of the same-sex people in Uganda are in the closet. When you come out, you finish. So you cannot blame someone for failing to understand something they have never been exposed to. It is our duty to expose them, to teach them, to empower them, and to tell them we are all human beings. Under the current conditions in Uganda, while we continue to see violence, arrests, people being thrown out of homes, schools, work, and many other places, we need to position ourselves to defend ourselves, because no one is defending us in Uganda. We need to defend ourselves. And we cannot generally expect this struggle to be won today. It takes time. Uganda's struggle started before I was born. These things take time. You might expect them to do 15 months, and then it takes 15 years. So, that's another problem. How do we respect time? How do we appreciate time? I've been doing this 12 years now. Sometimes I go to bed and I'm thinking, I mean, I'm a graduate of economics. I used to work with one of the leading banks in the country. And I go by and I'm like, am I really doing anything? It's just something else I can do. I mean, 10 years and instead of the laws going away, they are bringing new laws to kill me. Am I really making an impact? Am I doing the right thing? Is this where I'm supposed to be? We need to respect time. And time is something that you can take for granted if you are born in a country where the tide was already moving. When you're born in a country where the tide is moving backwards, you learn to appreciate time. You learn to appreciate that you will talk to one MP 5 times over 2 years, and at the end of the 2 years, they'll ask you the very first question they asked you again. Why did you give me wear yellow trousers? 2 years after talking to this person, it is the very reason we need to keep on talking to them. Because if you give up, then you're wasting 2 years. You need to look at just 2 years or 5 years as an investment and say, I've already put 5 years into this, I'm not stopping now. All those 5 years would have been wasted. Of course, activism is not easy. It's not a job. Like me, many of my colleagues have lost family, have lost friends, have lost lives. In the video we just saw before I came on stage, one of the people in that video is not alive today. He was hit with a hammer in January 2009. And he died. His name was David Kato. That's someone many of you might have seen in videos. But this kind of death happened so many times that it gets embarrassing to keep on reporting about them. People are inspired by the June month, the month of pride. Everyone comes out and dances, and some people come out to people they shouldn't have come out to, or they are not ready to come out to, and 3 months later they commit suicide because they are not yet ready. How do we make an environment where it is safe for someone to come out and continue with their job, for someone to come out and continue in school? Because in Uganda, to be in school, your fees need to be paid by your parents. How do you make sure that you can come out and still be guaranteed that your parents will pay your tuition? How do you make sure that you can come out and not be like me? When I came out for 5 years, I did not have contact with any of my family members because they felt that I was an embarrassment. They felt that I was putting the family to shame. I did not attend any funeral of any relative, any Christmas, anything. I was cut out completely. But you know, when people realize that you're not withering, when people realize that 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, you're going stronger in what you believe in, one or two of your relatives come back and say, but listen, tell me your story. I want to understand. Tell me your story. It's been 5 years now. What exactly do you think? What are you trying to achieve? And slowly, I started what I call a don't ask, don't tell relationship. Whereby we talk about football, we talk about cars, we talk about politics, we talk about the weather, we do not talk about sexual orientation. This is not good enough, but if that is what someone is offering you, we all need family. If I can talk to family and we're talking about the weather, so be it. Maybe in 2 years' time, something might happen on TV, oh, I like a fear on TV, I'm on TV so many times, and maybe the conversation is starting there. But how do you convince other people to join you in changing attitudes when they see what you're going through? When they see you watching your back all the time, how do you convince them that that's a good way to live your life? You go and tell, hey guys, I know you're gay. Come and join me. We need to fight for ourselves. And they'll be like, Dennis, you can't even ride on the public bus. You're always looking around you. Who wants to live like you? How do you get the community to appreciate that sacrifices have to be made? We just need to watch and see the people who have sacrificed and what the people after them are enjoying right now or are achieving right now. We need to continue sharing the success stories. It's extremely important to share success stories because then it gives other people hope that one day, maybe one day, in 10 years, in 20 years, in 5 years, we might be like that. When people do not listen to success stories, they get demoralized. They believe their fight is in vain. We have had issues with the judiciary. We have gone to court so many times. We have won some, we have lost some. But the point is, we are trying to show the public that even the court agrees that despite the laws, you cannot just violate LGBT people like that. Right now, I'm very proud to be one of three Ugandans who are suing the government for refusing to register Section Minorities Uganda. Section Minorities Uganda is the umbrella organization of LGBT people in Uganda. And they refuse to register it because they say the name is suspicious. So we are in court. And I say we have, as citizens, we have a right to associate. So we have a right to be registered because we don't break any law. This is a groundbreaking and it's a historic cause. That's why I'm doing it. And of course, when you search a petition, you're all over the papers, you're all over the TV, and it brings more insecurity to you. But this is a groundbreaking case. We need the courts to pronounce themselves. Can you or can you not register and speak for LGBT people? Then the dialogue can begin from there. If you want to change attitudes, you need to do it multi-pronged. You need to talk to the politicians. You need to deal with the judicial system. You need to deal with the churches. You need to deal with the individuals, the citizens. So we are doing it in every possible outlet we have. And it's slow, it's painful, but we count every success and go home and say, at least we got that. At least the court allowed us to put in a case. At least we have the lawyers willing to come out and speak. At least we have a constitution that has a bill of rights that we can use in challenging all these violences.